Welcome back to my channel. My name is Melanie and I make videos about living in Copenhagen. Today's video is going to be a little bit different. I'm going to make a short documentary video for you about a well-known Danish author called Tove Ditlevsen. Now, Tove was born in 1917 and she died by suicide in 1976, and she's probably one of the most well-known Danish authors. She's published around 29 books of poetry, short stories, autobiography and fiction, and I was really delighted. I help out on my son's school library, and as a gift to thank me for the work that I put in over the last year or so, the librarian Meta gifted me a book because she knows how much I love reading, and this was a book that meant something to her. It was a book that she really loves this author and she likes this book. And for the first time in 2019, Tove Ditlevsen's biography, it's in three volumes, it's called the Copenhagen Trilogy in English, was first published and translated in English as a volume of the three books. This is the book itself, you can see it there. There are three volumes in it. There is Childhood, Youth and Dependency, and it takes you through obviously from her early childhood to up to her 20s in the youth one, and then Dependency is the beginning of her, I guess, adult life, and goes through a period of drug dependency and several marriages. Now, Tove was roundly dismissed in literary circles, which were mainly, they were men basically. They didn't like her work. She was very much dismissed. She was put down. She was overlooked for a lot of literary prizes. And a quote I read by a Danish writer, this writer said that Tove was beloved by, and I'm paraphrasing here, was beloved by women and derided by men. And that went through much of her life. And she published 29 books, short stories, whatever. And she also wrote a column in a magazine here where she basically answered readers' questions. Now, in her book, she talks a lot about the struggles of being a female writer and wanting to break into literary circles, and how she struggled with that. I mean, even at the beginning when she's writing poetry, when she's 10 or 11, her father says, oh, women can't become poets. But she's so determined she's going to become a writer and a poet. And this book, really, I found very inspirational, taking you through her life. Now, it's called autofiction because she is a little bit of an unreliable narrator in it. There are some discrepancies. She says that she leaves her childhood home to move to a different place when she's like in her late teens, but actually records show that she lived there until she was 22. So there are some discrepancies there, but I found it a fascinating book, and it really, I mean, it's set in, a lot of it, childhood, the first volume, is set in Vesterbro, which now is a very hip and trendy part of town. But a lot of the places still look exactly the same. Like her home, the apartment building that she lived in looks the same. A lot of the places look a lot like they did then. And if you've read this book, and if you haven't read it, I really do urge you to read it. It's a fantastic book. You really want to feel and see what these places look like, because she describes them so well. And I thought, I love this kind of thing. I like looking at old photographs. I like looking at old footage and seeing where things were set. So I thought I'd make a video for you to see all the different places. And I'm going to take you a walk around Vesterbro and talk about the history of those places in relation to Tove's life. I found it really, really interesting to do, and I hope you enjoy watching it. But a little bit more about Tove. As I say, she was born in 1917, and she is probably one of the best known Danish writers. But she wasn't added, her books and her poetry were not added to the school curriculum here until, would you believe it, 2014, which I think is quite astounding. But now they're added to it. The school that she used to go to is now named after her, which you'll see a little bit more later on in the video. But if you enjoyed this book, as I did, you may be interested to find that also this year, this was published as a three volume one for the first time in 2019. Two different translators. The third book is translated by a different one from the first one, and I didn't feel it flowed quite the same. But the translator who translated the first one, Tina Nulali, she also translated this other book by Tove, which is called The Faces. Now, this is ostensibly a fiction book. It's about an author of children's books who basically descends into psychosis and drug addiction and ends up in a mental institution. And it follows through that whole journey from beginning to end when she leaves it. And there are a lot of things in this book that are almost identical to the ones in her autobiography. You know, small little anecdotal things in there, but you can really see how she took her own life and brought it into her fiction. And I really enjoyed both books. I read this one, it's a very short one. I read this in an afternoon. This one I probably knocked out in less than a week because I couldn't put it down. I thought it was so great. If you want to also see some kind of big screen stuff of Tove's, one of her books, Barndommens, which means Childhood Street, which isn't translated into English, is still only in Danish, was made into a film in the early 80s. And I'll put a link down below to that. But the main character was played by the actor Sophie Grabel, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with her woolly jumpers in the Danish version of The Killing. And she's probably around 11 or 12 in that. And she doesn't look at all like she looks as an adult. So I didn't really spot it straight away until I saw it in the sort of the titles as to who the actors were in it. But I hope you enjoy this video. I take you on quite a long walk around Vesterbro, seeing all these different places. And if you've read the book, you'll know where all these places are. And if you haven't read it, please do read it and then come back and watch the video again, and you'll be able to see all the places she talks about, from her childhood home, the library she goes to, the streets where she spends her time. I loved making the video and I hope you enjoy watching it. And if you do, please do give me a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel if you're not already a subscriber. So let's get into the video. Here you can see the back facade of the building that Tove grew up in up until the age of 22, although there is some discrepancy in her text and the facts that I've read about the time that she lived here. But she lived on the fourth floor of this building, and you can see the kind of very plain facade that the building had. I'm now standing in the yard in front of the building where Tove lived when she was growing up. Now, it says that she lived here until, there's a plaque out there which I'll show you, but it says that she lived here until she was the age of 22. However, in her book, she talks about moving to another part of the city called West End when she was 18. But she lived here in the back house. Now, it was very common at that time to have two kind of blocks of apartments. You had the front apartment, which would be here, and the back apartments, which were behind me. That's why it's 30A. The A indicates that it's the back building. Now, the finer people, as she says in her book, the finer people lived in the front part of the building, where they paid 2 crowns more a month for their rent. Now, that's the equivalent of around 20p in modern money. So the finer people lived here, and she lived behind me. Now, it's a 5-story building, which was very typical of the time, and they lived on the fourth floor. And this yard out here was where she talks about meeting, in the translation she talks about the trash can section of it, where the older girls used to gather and they used to talk about boys and gossip, and she wanted to be part of that group. And then when she does join the group, she realizes that actually they're terribly boring, which I think is something we all experience. You know, you think the cool girls are so exciting, and then when you get into perhaps the sort of the outer inner circle of them, you realize they're actually quite dull. But this yard would have been very, very different in those days. It would have been much darker and gloomier. There would have been obviously the rubbish out here. It would have smelt a little bit, and there would have been outdoor privies. Now, she talks about sitting in the bedroom window and looking down in the yard, and she sees people using the privy out here. Now, during the time that she lived here, there would have been an indoor toilet that they would have used, but there still would have been an outside privy. And the apartments would have been 2-room apartments. Now, when they say 2 rooms, that's like 2 living rooms, and there would have probably been a smaller kitchen and as I say, the small lavatory, which would have taken up some of the space within the apartment. And she lived there during that time with her older brother and her mother and father. And she talks in the book about sleeping in the bedroom with her mother and father, and her brother having the living room to sleep in. And when he gets older and he moves out towards Frederiksberg, then she gets that room herself. But she has to wait until everybody goes to bed before she can also go to bed. And she talks a lot about people, family members and friends of her parents coming round, playing cards and using the living space, and having to wait until they'd left before she could also go to sleep. Nowadays, the apartments have been changed quite a bit. Some of them have been knocked through, so that instead of being these two-room apartments on each floor, they're now four-room larger apartments. And I looked at the records, and the last time one was sold was in 1996, and it was at 1.7 million Danish kroner. Now, this was a working-class area. This wouldn't have been a particularly clean, aired place, and you know, poor people, although they were working, they were in and out of work a lot of the time, but it would have been what they called the proletariat would have lived here. Very different from today's gentrified Vesterbro that you see behind me. Now, reading the book, a large section of the first part of childhood, she talks a lot about spending time outside here in the yard. There were different kind of factions of ages of children that would have been out here. There was obviously the trash can girls who stood in the corner gossiping, and there were younger children that were playing. And this was very much the centre of her world before she was old enough to go out to what she calls her childhood street of Istegard. Now, this yard would have been very different then. It would have been much gloomier. It was shared obviously by the front and the back house, but the front house very much overshadows the yard, and it would have had obviously the rubbish bins out here, which would have been much smellier than they are nowadays. Where we've got bike sheds now, there would have been the outdoor privies, and it was a very, very different space to the pleasant and sunny space that you see today, with all these bikes and tables and chairs and blossom trees. But this was a very integral to her childhood, this yard, and reading the book you hear so much about it, and I thought it would be really nice for actually to show you what this yard looks like now. And I you know, it's not that much different to how it would have been during her day. This is a plaque which is just inside the kind of entrance tunnel that goes into the backyard where she lived, and it commemorates the fact that she lived here. She was born on the 14th of December 1917, lived on the fourth floor to Hoya, which tells us which side of the building that she lived in, and that she lived here until the age of 22. Now, she, as we know, is something of an unreliable narrator in her book, because she talks about living here until she's 17 or 18 before she moves. But that's what it says on the plaque. Okay, well, this is the entrance that she would have gone into her apartments here at 30A. Now, buildings like this were built towards the end of the 19th century, when the city needed to expand more, and were very, very working class buildings. The poor of Vesterbro lived in buildings like this, which is not the case nowadays. That staircase that pokes out in the middle is the staircase that runs up through the middle of the building, and there would have been two apartments on either side. Again, very, very common in Danish apartment buildings of this age. And although she doesn't say in the book which floor she lives on, we know that she lived on the fourth floor on the right. So it would have been, The ground floor is obviously zero, which is Stuen, and then you have 1, 2, 3, 4. So it would have been that top window on the flat side of the building, not the windows at the very top. And they're the windows that she talks about sitting at in the bedroom, looking over the yard. She watches people using the privy. She sees the children out here playing, and it's where she sits and she writes her poetry in her poetry book, which she hides from her family in various places in the bedroom, until she shows it to her brother. And he laughs at her poems, but then he admits that actually she's pretty good at writing poetry. Now, we're very lucky that we can see what her apartment would have looked like. Now, this is an apartment set up exactly as it would have been in the 1920s. And it's in the Workers' Museum, which is very close to Norreport Station. And this is the living room. And as you can see, they were also lucky, like her family were, to have a small transistor radio, which is in pride of place on the table. And that would have been for entertainment and listening to news. And it was a really big thing for them. And looking around here, again, like her apartment, you've got a stove in the corner, as they would call it, which would heat up the apartment. And this room would be very warm. As she talks about, this is the warm room, and the bedroom is always very cold. Now, this apartment, in its entirety, there's a kitchen which I'm going to show you in a minute, was donated by a family, Sorensen, when their mother died. Now, she died in the 1990s, and they donated it to the museum then. And this is exactly as it was at the time of her death. So it was like it was in the 1920s at that time. Now, they donated the entire apartment, excluding the bedroom, because they felt that was a little bit too intimate to be displayed to the public. But this would have been almost exactly like Tora's apartment would have been, with, you know, this kind of day bed almost, where her brother slept, and latterly she also slept when her brother left home, and the stove in the corner and the dining table in the middle. And over here, you've got the kitchen, which again would have been like her kitchen was. You've got this almost like a small sort of Arga type cooker there. You've got a sink, obviously no refrigerator, but this would have been a very modern at the time kitchen. And when they got indoor lavatories, a corner of the kitchen would have been used and taken up with a sort of a small partitioned wall, I guess, with a toilet in it. So you can see that they lived in very, very close quarters as a family of four in an apartment like this. And I think this is a wonderful privilege to be able to see an apartment as it was in this museum. So I would really urge you, if you're in Copenhagen, to make a visit to the Workers' Museum. The whole museum is an amazing experience and gives you a real insight into the lives of working class people in Copenhagen from the end of the 19th century all the way through to the 1950s. Now, we know that she lived on the fourth floor of her apartment, but all apartments in Copenhagen, as well as those front stairs, they would also have these back, what they would call sort of servant stairs in more affluent apartments, but ones that would go out into the backyard. Now, in her apartment, they didn't actually have that. The front, because she was in the back house, the front stairs would go down into the yard. But in many apartments, this would be what the back stairs would be like. Now, this is an outside privy, and you might remember she talks about the man, if you've read the book, the man going into the toilet there. So, should we see if the toilet's free?
Ej, oh. Kan ikke se, det er et lokum. Man kan sgu da aldrig få lov at sidde her og skide i fred.
Oh, sorry. Now, no matter how many times I come down in this yard and I open that door, it always, always startles me. But yeah, so that's what an outdoor privy would look like. Do you want to be startled by him again? Here he is. Now, can you imagine that this is what it would be like? That you'd have these outdoor privies and your neighbours would be in there, and you could come upon them and startle them, rather like we did that man there. So this would have been the area around where she lived during the time up until the age of 17 or 22, whatever age you take it as. And if you get rid of all this car storage down here and some of the modern replacement buildings, you could imagine that it was at the time when she was living here at the beginning of the 20th century. And the buildings are very much as they were in those days. But her life was very much centered around this collection of streets here and around Istergel, the main sort of one of the main streets through Vesterbro, where she, when she's a little older, she goes and she spends time with the older children like Ruth from her building. But her life would have been very much in this area. She would have shopped in this area. She went to school across the street, literally across the street from where she lived. And it was unfathomable for her mother to even consider that Tove would have taken a job anywhere else in the city. She says in the book that her mother would almost consider, you know, that as impossible as taking a job in America, even though Copenhagen is quite a small city. So they lived a very parochial life in this part of the city. Behind me you can see what is currently Vesterbro Library, and it's been a library since 1930, but during Tove's childhood and into her youth, this was where her mother used to go around twice a month to a public bathhouse. These were very common at that time because although many apartments would have had an indoor lavatory, they still had privies out in the yard, but they wouldn't have had a bathroom with a separate bath in. So this was somewhere that her mother used to go to have a bath. And she talks about it in the book, about her mother liking to go because she basically had pride in her appearance and this was where she went. But reading about it, it doesn't sound like it's the luxury experience that we have now if we go to a spa. There would have been women there known as vaskedamer, washer ladies, and they would have scrubbed your back down with a mixture of hemp and soap. Now, when they talk about soap, I don't think they're talking about, you know, some kind of, you know, luxury soap that we have nowadays. But this would have been quite a treat for people to have gone to a public bathhouse like this. Now, inside it is now a public library, but the outside looks very much like it would have done during Tove's time when it was that public bathhouse. Now here I am sitting on the steps outside the entrance to Vesterbro Library on New School Girl, Now, this probably would have been the entrance that Tore's mother would have used to have entered the bathhouses, or possibly one on the side. Looking at archive photographs of this building from that time, there was an illuminated sign that stuck out that said Bell on it, bath in Danish. And this would have been where she would have come to have that twice monthly bathing experience. Now, Vesterbro has become very much more gentrified over the last 15 years, but this library and culture house, which opened in 1930 as a library, is a very, very important social meeting place in the area. It has a huge children's library and a normal reading room. Downstairs there is a women's shelter, and there's also rooms here that are used for education for young people who are not in mainstream education, but to help them get their qualifications so that they can progress in life. And it is really quite an important hub in the area and an important aspect of the social fabric of Vesterbro today. So this is the actual school building that Tove went to school at until she was the age of 14, when she had to leave to get a job, despite being very academically gifted and her teachers feeling that she should continue with her education. Her family needed her to bring money into the household, which was very common in those days. So her education finished at 14. She was lucky that she continued that long, because a lot of girls would have left school much earlier than that. So she would have just run straight across the street. You can see the red buildings over there is at the end of her street where she lived. So she would have come straight across here to this school. And as I say, it looks exactly like it would have done in her day. Now then it was called Matthias Girls School. There were a lot of schools in this area because it was a very populous area, but this was the one she went to. And it's now, since I think 2008, it's changed its name, and it's named after her as probably their most famous alumni from the school. And the square outside is also named after her. I'm now standing in a slightly grander street than the ones where Tore grew up. But literally we're about 4 or 5 minutes away from the school that she went to. And this street is called Valdemarsgade. Now in the book Childhood, this street has quite an integral part of her story. It's where she joined the children's library. When she's age 10, she's allowed to join the children's library. And I don't know which building it is in this street, because it no longer exists. Obviously the new library in 1930 opened, but behind me is a building that I'd like to imagine was like the building where she went to this children's library. And the library was run by a librarian who was a great inspiration to Tore. And this librarian, she'd learnt about being a librarian in Pittsburgh in the United States. And she came here and she wanted to replicate what she'd seen in that city. That librarian's name was Helga Mullerup, and she was the founder of what is the current library in Vesterbro. She opened that in 1930, and she really, from starting a tiny library down this street, which was just three rooms for a small children's library, she believed, from what she'd learnt in her training in Pittsburgh in the US, that libraries are more than just about books. So when she started this library down this street, the three-room library that Tore went to, and she borrowed, she was bored of the children's books there immediately, and she asked to borrow a book by Victor Hugo, and the librarian corrects her pronunciation of his name, and I also pronounced it wrong then. But she comes down here, and this is where she really starts to get her true discovery of knowledge and reading. But it is just a stone's throw from where she grew up. The buildings down here an awful lot grander than they were in the streets, those working class streets that she lived in. And she would come down here from the age of 10 and use this library. But the librarian, she really believed that libraries are more than just about books. And when she opened the new library in Vesterbro, where it currently is now, in 1930, she wanted that children's library to be more than just about books. And it's the oldest and the first children's library in Denmark. And she had what we associate now with libraries for children. She had music and theatre and reading times and activities. And she realised that this area was very, very socially deprived in those days. And children needed that. They needed somewhere to go. And I think that that is borne out with what you read in Tore's book, Childhood, how important this library, this three-room library down this street, was to her and her formative years. Although at first glance the buildings down Valdemarsgade appear to be much grander than those of the working class streets where Tove lived, they would have been part of the fabric of the poor life of Vesterbro at the time. Both this red building and the one adjacent to it would have been what we would refer to in the UK as perhaps almshouses or workhouses, poor houses. So you would have still had a lot of the poor of Vesterbro would have been living and existing in this street. So it seems even more relevant that Helga Muller decided to open her children's library down this street, because it was an area and it was a street where that kind of opportunity was very important to young people, to get that start in life of the love of reading and also the access to books. In some of the passages in the book, Tove talks about people that she goes to their houses, like relatives and different people who have no books in their homes. And her family, particularly her father, is very much a bookman, a reader, less so her mother. And when she starts at her very first primary school, at the age of, I think, about five, she can already read. And the teacher, the head teacher, chastises her mother and says, "We don't like this. You know, why have you done this? She must learn to read here." And her mother almost backs away from her and seems ashamed that her daughter has this ability to be able to read. And obviously that's what goes through her life. And she does, although she grows up in that working class background, a lot of her life is sort of all about intellectual pursuits and her writing of her poetry. And she's told by her father that girls cannot become poets. And I think that, you know, we can see that in her case and for many other women that wasn't the case. But it was very much that she was sort of different to those around her. But Helga Muller saw that and supported her in the time that she was going to that children's library. I'm standing on a busy junction on Istergel and Gasworks by, and Tove talks about this part of town in her books. Now, she spends time as she gets older on Istergel, and she talks about it as her childhood street, and she hangs out here with Ruth from her building, who, although is younger than her by a little bit, is much more worldly. And they come down mainly to the end of the street that is closer to her home, which is that way. But going this way up towards, with this boundary of Gasworks by, which means Gasworks Street, she says this is the boundary between the decent and the depraved. And it's still a little bit like that now, even though Vesterbro is very much more gentrified than it ever used to be. Even when I first moved here, you know, there was a lot of open drug use on the streets here, which has been cleaned up with the injecting room. But that run up there towards the station still holds a little bit of the same kind of atmosphere as it did in her day. You know, she talks about there being rowdy bars there, women on the street corners to meet men, and Ketty, a lady in her building, comes up here, a lady that her mother somewhat admires and her father disapproves of. And she finds this quite a daring, Tove finds this quite a daring part of town to go to. And as I say, not a lot has really changed, although it's much cleaner and much safer than it used to be. But it still holds that kind of feeling of what this part of Vesterbro was like in her day. I really hope you enjoyed that video. I loved making it. As I said earlier, if you're not already a subscriber, please do hit the subscribe button so you don't miss any more videos going forward. And until next time, bye for now.